I'm teaching new fish old tricks. No, I'm not teaching fish to play basketball. I wish I was. What I'm actually doing is teaching fish about predators through fear. And yes, that is a goldfish. I work on set. But first, I'll start with the why. So, we're looking at the cradles of civilization, waterways, riverways around the world. Humanity started at these places, the Tigris and Euphrates, the Ganges River, the Nile River Delta. The sad reality is that these places are now under threat. From pollution in the Ganges, to damming projects and invasive species, these fragile ecosystems are under threat constantly, and the situation is only getting worse. And while for you and I, here in this wonderful room here, you know, we're safe, we're okay, but there are over 1 billion people on the planet who rely on fish and fish from these freshwater systems as their sole source of protein. And what that means is that for these individuals, whether or not the system is being degraded, they're gonna keep going to get this fish, but this is at the expense of their health as well as the rest of the system. And so what we wanna do is maintain these riverways so that they can go back to these rivers to collect fish for generations to come. And now there's two ways we can look at this on how we're gonna save these systems. Well, we can look at the habitat side. We can look to preserve these systems, maybe like E.O. Wilson's half-earth hypothesis and keep it pristine, or we can help the things that are living in these systems, namely these fish, adapt to this rapidly changing climate. And that's personally the way I go. I want to help them adapt. I do my work through hatcheries. So this is a hatchery system. It's actually based out of New Brunswick in eastern Canada. And hatcheries have played an immensely important role in the restoration of these rivers. Hatcheries are a heavenly place for fish species because you can grow these fish to as large as you want before you restore them, put them back in these rivers with no predators involved. However, that's also an issue. Because there are no predators involved, these fish are naive. And so, they don't quite understand what's going on when something wants to eat. So our next question is, well, how do we teach these fish to be afraid? We know they're smart. Yes, they are smart, contrary to popular belief. And we just have to think of what the best way to teach them is. They rely on vision and smell in order to learn about their surroundings. We also know that there's a chemical under the skin that helps them to understand what's in their environment. In fact, if a fish is eaten by a predator, the other fish that smell essentially the blood and this chemical that's being released know not only what the fish that was just eaten, how related it was to it, but also the size of the predator, which is very important when you want to know if that fish that just got eaten is about the same size as you, and if that thing lurking in the shadows is going to come and get you as well. Unfortunately, these hatchery-raised fish don't get these cues, so this is a place we can use to teach them. So essentially what I want to do is take these fish, kind of in a giant goldfish bowl, so in a hatchery system, flood them with this cue that comes from that skin extract of related fish species. And the idea is to increase their baseline level of fear. By doing so, we make them more cautious. So when we put them out in the wild, they're not going to be eaten. And so the gist of the experiment, actually I'll get to that in a second. I do this work out in Miramichi in New Brunswick, eastern Canada. This riverway right here. And I work on Atlantic salmon, 8 to 12 weeks old. They're about 3 centimeters. They're really, really tiny, really cute. And they're F1 generation fish. So that means that they're born of wild-caught parents, but they themselves have never seen the wild. Essentially what I'm doing is I'm giving fish post-traumatic stress disorder so that when you raise them in the hatchery and you release them into the wild, they're not eaten. And you're probably wondering, well, how do you do this? Be something to do with the alarm cue. Well, you're correct. I have them swim in a soup of their ground-up brothers and sisters. So you can't really see it here, but there are 4 enclosures in that river system that I set up. They're about 1 meter by 4 meters. And I stock each one with about 11 to 12 fish each. Half of them remain as a control in this river system, so they don't really get anything, they're just sitting in this net. while the other half are given this alarm cube, so that skin extract, for 3 days. Now at the end, on the fourth day, I take them one by one and place them in a bin that's in the river, and give them 5 minutes to get used to this new environment. I mean, it's pretty stressful being moved from this enclosure to a bin all by yourself. And then for the next 5 minutes, I measure two important variables, the time spent on substrate and the number of foraging attempts. And the reason is because the time spent on substrate is going to, or we predict, that it would decrease, or sorry, increase, because if you're afraid, you're just going to freeze. You have that freezing behavior. And the number of foraging attempts will decrease, because hopefully, if you're afraid, you're not going to want to go around eating as much as you see. I will then give them this novel odor, so that something they've never, ever experienced before. So it's actually vanilla extract, so they smell it too. Or the stream water control. At which point, for another 5 minutes, I will measure the same two variables. So, on the first graph we have here, the data from that was actually analyzed through a man-readable U-test, because it is non-parametric, as many behavioral measures are. Looking at it, so on our x-axis, we have our risk environment, so for that 3-day period, whether or not they were getting that skin extract soup, against the number of foraging attempts. And unfortunately, the graph isn't too visible, but what is important, actually, you'll see, I'll just point out. Essentially, you just see a big block like this. And what we would expect is that this block, which is here, should actually be decreasing. However, we did not see that to be the case. On this graph, similar thing, except this time we're looking at the change in the time on substrate versus that elevated risk, or rather, the elevated risk level versus the change in time on substrate. There's a box right here. That should, we would expect, increase because they should be freezing. However, we do not see that to be the case either. And so what this essentially tells us, there's no effect of this background risk level on their behavioral response. And so that these fish that are born to these wild-caught parents are not becoming more cautious. And there's a number of reasons why this might be the case. I mean, there could be genetic reasons, just as some people learn in different ways than others. There could be social reasons, because sometimes fish will see their best friend and think, you know what, he's pretty cool and he's very bold and he doesn't want to be afraid, so I'm going to be more like him. And then, you know, consequently not react to this fish's gut soup. And so the possible reasons are tremendous. But that also leads me to my next work. So in actually a few weeks, I'll be heading to Windsor, Ontario, on the other side of Lake Erie, and I'll be looking at fish that have been bred for multiple generations in a hatchery system. So not just that F1 generation, but F3, 4, 5, 6, 7, because potentially there is something that might be either bred in or bred out that will allow them to be more easily trained. Furthermore, I'll be looking at different genetic strains. So by having multiple strains, maybe there's one population or one strain that we can train. So instead of wasting time with a population that isn't learning the way we expect, we could start doing more work with this strain. And with that, I would like to say thank you very much to these amazing people, my supervisor, Dr. Grant Brown, the Miramichi Sound Association, NSER, QCS, FRQ&T, I've had that up there, Concordia University, and to all of you.